Good evening, everybody. I'm Radhika Gupta, and on behalf of Edelweiss and Edelweiss Mutual Fund, we're delighted to welcome you to another edition of Edelweiss Connect. Firstly, I hope that as we're speaking, we live in very unique times and not easy times, and I hope you and your families and loved ones are safe in whichever part of the country or world you're tuning in from. As I said, these are unique times, these are unprecedented times, these are incredible times. And when we at Edelweiss were thinking about the kind of conversation we wanted to bring you through the Connect platform in these times, I don't think we could have found a better speaker than our speaker today. He's someone who's seen all kinds of difficult times. He's someone who's seen war front. He's seen the military, he's worked with governments, he's worked in corporate India, he understands people, leadership and mindsets from so many different point of views. Captain Raghu Raman does not need an introduction, but I have the pleasure of doing a formal introduction, so I will do that. Captain Raghu is a soldier, former founder and CEO of NatGrid, former president of Reliance Industries. And many of you know him as a writer of articles, of books, and of course, a storyteller. His fan base ranges from people who are children and in their teens to people from all strata. So I think today we've got a remarkable attendance and a lot of people who have tuned in to hear him. That is the formal part of the introduction, but I can't do this introduction without sharing my own interaction with him. I met Captain Raghu about 3 years ago at a training event that Edelweiss had organized for senior leadership. And I was, as usual, a little suspect about training events. And there I met Captain Raghu. And what I can say is, in the interaction I had with him and since then, he has turned my life upside down for good, and taught me so much about so many things. He's taught me a lot about leadership. He's taught me a lot about storytelling, and he's taught me a lot about knowing myself better. So while I've done many different Connect events and moderated sessions with incredible personalities and speakers, I am actually very nervous today. Captain, in one of his stories, gives this example or analogy of the Ustad and Shagird today. So this time it's a very nervous Shagird introducing Ustad. Captain, we are very, very happy to have you and so delighted to have you. Just before I hand it over to Captain, in terms of the format for the event, Captain's going to be talking to us for about 40, 45 minutes. And I know there are many of you who have questions both through the YouTube platform and the VouchPro platform. So if you have any questions, please pose them and we'll come to the Q&A at the end of the session. So please put in your questions. And without taking any further time, Captain, the stage is all yours.
All right. Thanks a ton. Thank you, Radhika, for those wonderfully kind words. I'm blushing more red color than your background and your dress. And I'm very happy that a CEO of a financial company should be of a suspicious type of anybody, not just trainers, of anything, because after all, people are trusting you with their money. So thank you once again for your very, very kind words. And I want to clarify that much of what I have shared with you are lessons that I myself learned from various ustads. So it's in the probably the tradition of passing on what one has learned, adding your own experiences and all of that stuff. And I'm sure you do that, and you are doing it as well. And a large part of what you call your makeover is exactly that. You're basically taking the experiences that you have, which is, I think, the job of all leaders. I think all leaders should do that. what I'm going to share with everyone today, and I realize that we have family members and maybe even teenage kids sitting over there during this session, and they should. If they're not there, you should call them, because this is not about investment. This is not about... It is about, I think, some fundamental principles of life which are very important, especially during time of a crisis, the one that we are facing today. So I don't want to get into the adjectives and all of that, because I'm sure we have been bombarded by all sorts of similarities with Second World War and flu and pandemic and all of that. But there is no argument that even as I'm speaking to you right now, not a single one of us in the audience is removed by 1 degree, and in some unfortunate cases by 0 degree of separation from somebody who has been impacted, perhaps fatally, because of COVID. We also know that tens of crores of Indians will be pushed down at least one economic strata. You know, in the person who was planning to buy a budget car will probably have to buy a two-wheeler. Person who was planning to buy a two-wheeler will have to stick with the cycle. Person who probably admitted his child in an English medium school may have to bring her back into. And even if we conquer this pandemic in 2 years' time or 3 years' time, and we look back in the year 2024 and say, okay, that mess is behind us, there would have been some sort of a permanent damage that would have happened for an entire generation, because that kid who was dropped out of a English medium school and maybe dropped out of education in 2 years' time is perhaps not going to go back into the education stream. So I think we will have to start thinking about a world post the pandemic and during the pandemic. So that's going to be the challenge. And some of these principles that I am going to share with you will remind us of why the world around us has changed and why, therefore, our thinking also needs to change. So, you know, I was doing this session for a bunch of B-school students a couple of weeks ago, and they complained. They said, sir, bade mushkil se we had remembered the full form of VUCA. Now we have gone and changed it into another full form of rupture. So I said, I haven't changed it. It was actually changed 2 years ago, well before the pandemic. But VUCA, as we all realize or remember, is volatile, uncertain, complex. But in ruptured world, the acronym is slightly different. The R stands for rapid. And let me give you an example of the rapidity with which. So this is an anecdote which I think had relevance maybe a few months ago, but I think the current example overtakes it. But when 8th of March last year, not this year, last year, I was in Goa with a company, Infosys actually, and Infosys BPM, and they were celebrating their crossing of a $1 billion revenue. And they had called all the leaders from all parts of the globe. And the CEO, old friend, was very, very proud. And he was saying, you know, all my leaders are here except from China and I think Japan. You know, there's some flu going on there. Some virus is happening there. And this was on the 8th of March. And on 28th of March, our world changed completely. And that's the rapidity with which the world has changed. Uncertainty was there earlier also, but now the degree of uncertainty is of a different scale. Because if I asked you, are you going to be free day after tomorrow evening, you might be able to give me an answer in a yes or a no. If I tell you, will you be free on Wednesday next fortnight, you have no idea. Because next fortnight, Wednesday, world would have changed completely. Lockdown may have come, any other thing may have happened. Maybe, God forbid, a close family member may have been taken ill. And each one of these elements, it's become a paradoxical world. Paradoxical means that increasingly our decisions will not have to be between a right and a wrong. It will have to be between one right and another right. Or more unfortunately, more often, one wrong and another wrong. Because no matter what, you take a decision of a lockdown, you know the economic impact that it will cause. You allow business to happen, that has an impact. So it's two bad decisions between which leaders will have to consistently choose. And this is also translatable to the kind of decisions we will have to take in our daily lives, both in our organizational capacities and as individuals, as fathers, as brothers, as mothers, we'll have to take those decisions. I'm sure, even as I'm talking to you, many family members, many women may be struggling with focusing on their own parents or the family that they're married into. All of these challenges we are going to face. And then, of course, is the fact that the world has become increasingly tangled. So I'll tell you a story for this. When this pandemic began, the first wave began as part of a committee which was set up to determine what should be essential services. So, of course, unanimously, it was decided that communication is essential services, because without communication, you can't do anything. You can't even do governance. But if communication is essential services, then the 4 lakh towers, mobile towers in this country, 4 lakh odd towers, these towers become essential services. Most of these towers are powered by generators. So the diesel, and which has to be put in that diesel supply chain becomes essential services. These towers have routers, radio modems, which have to be adjusted constantly. And these young engineers climb up and do it all the time. Now those engineers become essential services. They stay in chamaris and hostels and paying guest accommodation, PG hostels. Those become essential services. They eat out of cafeterias and restaurants and dabba services. So suddenly you realize that life does not move in this convenient zone of a gated colony and outside the world. These two are connected together. So if there's a lockdown, the fruits will stop coming in. Nature's fresh because nobody's sowing those crops at the other end of the supply chain. So I think the world is also extremely tangled now. Any decision taken will have multiple consequences, which many of them will be unanticipated. And this is the world. that our children are going to grow in, our teenagers are going to be influenced by, our decision making is going to be influenced by. Now, in this scenario, there are certain principles of thinking, which these principles have been honed and refined over periods, centuries of strategic thinkers who specially thought during crises. They were people who were advising, say, Churchill during the time England stood alone. How was the decision taken? How did people take? What was the framework used? These principles are based on that. So let me begin with the first one, and this is a riddle that some of us may have, you know, heard in our childhood, or more probably in WhatsApp. The story goes something like this: that there is a ship which is tied up in the harbor, and in the harbor the tide goes down. During low tide, the tide goes down, and the tide goes down by 1 foot every hour. So each hour the tide goes down by 1 foot. And on the side of the starboard side of this ship, you've got a ladder, a step ladder, which goes down into the water. And the ladder has rungs which have distance of 1 foot between each other. Now, if we calculate and say that it takes an hour for the tide to come down 1 foot, and the distance between these rungs is 1 foot each, how many hours will it take for three of those rungs to be uncovered by the lowering tide? It's a simple question. Intuitive answer is it will take 3 hours, because every hour the tide goes down, 1 hour is the 1 foot distance, and there are three rungs, a foot distance between each. But the real answer is that when the tide goes down, the ship will also go down. The ship will also go down, the ladder will also go down. So if you are looking at that rung of your ship to determine whether you are sinking a little bit in your thinking, in your clarity of thinking, in terms of morale or whatever, so no, things are okay and things are fine, and we have migrated to online and we are doing Zoom classes and our children are attending school through Zoom. There is distinctly a difference between an environment where children grow up in, say, a co-educational school, in a single gender school, and homeschooling. That difference cannot be moved by just transmitting everything to Zoom or online. There will be an impact. There will be an impact in the way our customers behave. There'll be an impact in the way people behave. There'll be an impact in which leadership will have to change. I'll give you some examples. All of us recognize this. I'm sure many of us have used it in our in good old years when travel was happening. But this is the iconic London Tube map, and it's a brilliant piece of human engineering and thinking. And it is also, by the way, the foundation for, many of you would know this, the foundation for most of the tube maps, subway maps of the world. It's a brilliant map to navigate within the tube. You can actually plan trips and journeys literally with a couple of minutes of changeover between trains. But if you try to use this map outside the London tube, it'll be a disaster. Matter of fact, even the engine drivers don't use this map to drive the train. So a map that is very, very useful in a certain set of circumstances, if we use the same map in a different set of circumstances, that map will become a disaster. Pretty much every map that we have written, the way we think about processes, the way we think about procurement, the time it takes for a corporate to hire an employee, the time it takes to dispense 100 crores worth of investments, or the time it takes to source 100 crores worth of equipment. We are all aware now, we keep reading in the newspapers, these ventilators are lying unused and boxes are lying in airports and all of that. But I'll tell you, I have worked in the government for 5 years, and I'll tell you the reason why. The reason is that the ventilator which would have come would have a 110 volt plug and 110 volt wiring. Now the transformer which is required, because here everything is 220, the cost of the transformer may be some 2000 rupees. But the authority here does not have the empowerment to spend 2000 rupees like that, because it's sovereign fund, so tender has to be taken out or some other. Now, these are the challenges of the old map, the old world. And we are trying to use the same map to navigate. And it's not just about the government, it's happening in corporates also. And I'm pretty sure it must be happening even in households, right? So, I mean, why would we not think about paying our household help every week? Why would we say 30-day payment cycle? That was in a different world. Now it's a different world. Maybe we should front load the salary for the next 6 months and give it to them now. So these are the ways we have to constantly keep thinking when we are navigating in a different world. We can't be using the maps of the previous world. And this is one of the major points that I wanted to stress upon, ironically, in a webinar itself. But I think it's very important to stress it in a webinar, that this assumption that many of us have that whatever we were doing in the real world, if we take it into a webinar and put it in Zoom, we have achieved the efficiency, or at least we achieved part of the efficiency, is not really true. In the real world, we depend a lot on our vibes, on our presence. You sit in a meeting. When I used to do my reviews, I look at, let's say, the North Zone head is giving his review. I'm looking at his face. I'm also looking at the South Zone head's face. I'm looking at the face of some youngster in the back who's champing on the bit to say something, but he's scared. He's not able to say it. And I can use leadership tools available to me to say, hey, buddy, I want to listen to somebody who I've not heard till now. Okay, you, what's your name? Why don't you say something? And pull out that person. These things are not available in the virtual world when we are trying. You can rebuke a person in a sharp tone during a presentation and then put your hand around him when you're walking out of the presentation and say, hey, buddy, that is a bit too much. And don't make these kind of promises with you. You can't do that in a webinar. So many of the structures of leadership, communication, which is one of them, most important one of them, which we relied on the real world, cannot be translated into the digital world without losing a high degree of fidelity. So our assumption that the efficacy of our command and control and our leadership tools is the same just because we are on Zoom is a big fallacy. We are navigating with a completely not only wrong map, but also wrong battle procedure. So I think this is something we need to think about and re-engineer from ground up. One of the lessons that I personally found very, very useful in life, especially in positions of crisis and situations when, I mean, I've done about six startups and 2-3 turnarounds, which is usually a chaotic environment. And in that chaotic environment, I found this principle, which I have learned, which is taught to everybody in the army, has stood me in very good stead. And I think we should encourage this even in our personal behavior, not just organizational behavior. So every army unit has an appointment called an adjutant. And this adjutant is kind of, think of him as the EA++. He's the right-hand man of the commanding officer, man or woman. And pretty much everything that happens in the unit is routed through. Think of him as a chief of staff kind of a role. Now, let's say a patrol which has gone out in an operational area in Punjab, which has gone out at, say, 11 o'clock at night and is scheduled to return at about 2 o'clock in the morning. That patrol enters into the gates. So the adjutant will be informed first. The gate garrison gate sentry will call up the adjutant and say, sir, the vehicles which had gone to do that Patiala run or whatever, they have come back. 10-15 minutes later, the adjutant will be woken up again. And this time the call will be from the motor transport NCO. And he'll say that the vehicles, 8 vehicles which had gone on the patrol, 4 one-tons, 2 jongas, this thing, that thing, gypsies, they have returned back. Okay, fine. After 15 minutes, he'll be woken up again. And this time the call will be from the armory NCO. And he'll call and he'll say that the weapons which are at the patrol has come. Pretty. Now by this time, you have to imagine the adjutant would have woken up 5:30 in the morning, gone to sleep at some ungodly hour, and he's woken up at 2 o'clock. Then he's woken up again at 2:15. He might be tempted to shout on the phone, I know. We are trained never to do that. We are trained that every call has a very, very specific purpose. The gate sentry is telling us that the vehicles rolled in at 2 a.m. in the morning. The motor transport NCO is telling us the vehicles have not deviated from the laid down route. The odometer matches with the track mileage book, and it is now in fit condition to be launched into operations tomorrow. There are no major defects. Everything is okay. The armory NCO is confirming that all the weapons and the ammunition which were issued for this particular mission have all been returned. No bullet has been lost or a grenade has been lost or something like that. And when finally the patrol leader gives his briefing, the three previous calls act as a audit mechanism. So he can't maro a satta, sir, actually I came at 1:50. He can't do that because he knows that the garrison NCO has already informed the garrison sentries. So I think this structure is a beautiful framework to operate in a crisis. But the underlying part of the structure is that we must, as leaders, constantly encourage information to come to us. If somebody calls us, that person must be left with a high. Should never be, I know about it. I already know. A lot of us have been brought up in a school of leadership where not knowing was considered to be a flaw in a leader. And therefore, the leaders many times won't even know, but pretend to know. We still have many of them. Maybe we do it. Maybe I do it at times. We all do it. But I think we need to realize that that is perhaps not a good idea. And even if we know a particular piece of information, when it comes to us, we must make the messenger feel really, really happy about it. This is a very important story I want to share with you, and this is the story of a sport in the Olympics, which is, by the way, one of the words of the Olympic motto: stronger, higher, faster. So this is higher, this is the high jump, and many of you who are watching this high jump might know a story behind it, which is the origin of the Fosbury flop. Now, this high jump was always attempted by a runner coming, athlete coming, running and extending his leg up and then the torso and jumping over, like we jump over fences as kids. We must have jumped over walls or maybe even jumped over high jump that way. Until in the 68 Olympics, you had this 21-year-old civil engineer. He wasn't even a professional athlete. Matter of fact, he was so immature that when he did the final run, he was wearing a pair of shoes which were mismatched. And he came running and he created history by not only scaling the highest height and breaking the record, but changing the game forever. And the game was changed forever because instead of leading with the leg, he led with the head and he created this thing called the Fosbury flop, which is now the way 9 out of 10 world records are held. It's the Fosbury flop. Now, this story many people may have heard also in the past. And there is a lesson to be taken there that it was a 21-year-old civil engineer who came and took the gold medal, not the old, giants like Cisco, Telepresence, and FaceTime and Skype. It was a guy called Zoom who came in and literally occupied the pole position. There is a reason for that. And that is the second part of the lesson that I think we need to take away, which is a more important part of the lesson. Usually not very well known, but I think the most important part of the lesson. Before the 60s, the landing surface of the high jump consisted of a sand pit, which was dug with sand. The kind we have done in school. I'm sure all of us have done at least long jump, and you come running and you jump, and it's basically a pit in which sand has been put. No fancy foams and mattresses in our time. That had started changing to foam mattresses. So while everyone was looking at how to jump over the pole, Dick Fosbury was also looking at the landing surface and saying, what are the risks I can take because the landing surface has changed? You can't land on a sand pit on your neck or on your head, but on a foam mattress you can. And therefore, you can change your game completely. And I think that is the way we have to start thinking in first principles during this crisis. To be able to do that, we also need another very, very necessary trait in leaders. I'm also realizing we're all learning leadership on a daily basis, but this trait is very important. And it's the humility to relearn, because many of us on this webinar would be exceedingly successful people. We are, because we belong. If you are on this webinar, you belong to 0.01001% of Indian humanity. So very clearly, we have a sense of intellectual arrogance. After all, we are well educated. We have taken the right bets. We have become CEOs at young ages and all of that stuff. So sometimes we get this sense of arrogance and we don't have the humility to learn. And I think that's why we need to have the humility to keep relearning. And this is one of my favorite stories to narrate, to illustrate that point. And this story goes back 18, 20 years ago in the district of Ambalapura in Kerala. And most of you would be aware, those who have gone for that houseboats there, you've basically been to Ambalapura district. And in that district, it's basically a fisherman's district. A lot of fishing folk who go into the high seas. So there was a district magistrate there, DM, the young IS officer, who had some surplus funds, and he decided to buy these fishermen GPSs. This is well before mobile phones, smartphones and all that. So he bought them GPS. They didn't know what a GPS was. They tried to figure it out, but in the end, they figured out. They figured out what a GPS is. Now, my friend had given them this GPSs so that in case of a storm or in case of bad weather, they can navigate back home. Now, he forgot that these fishermen were the children of seagoing fisher folk for centuries. They don't go into the sea when it's bad weather. Secondly, they know, they can figure out, they can look at the clouds, they can look at the birds flying, and they can figure out their way back home. They don't need this GPS to do that. So a complete waste of money. Or so we thought. But this is what the fishermen did. They went to the fish market. We've all been to fish markets. What kind of place that is. They would collect all the garbage, the rotting vegetables, the rotting stuff, kachada, vachada, everything. And they would fill it in gunny sacks, into sacks, and tie up the sacks and take it to the high seas and drop it in that spot with the GPS. And when they came back there the next day, 24 hours later, the place would be teeming with fish attracted by that garbage. So my educated, erudite friend gave them a technology device to navigate back home, and my illiterate country cousins used it to navigate into the sea, create more wealth, lower the carbon footprint, manage the supply and demand in the markets in a more reasonable manner. I think we need to learn that there is incredible learning out there, which is not necessarily only coming from Ivy League case studies and all that. It's happening all around us. And I'll tell you one more important point illustrating that. For that creativity, I think in any crisis, if a team has to come out of a crisis, and I'm being slightly maybe practical here, but it is better to be practical, is that most crises are the ones in which the world changes. I'll give you a very simple example. The Second World War suddenly saw the advent of fighter aircrafts. Before that, pilot training program, you were training pilots to fly at 400 kilometers per hour, 400, 500 kilometers per hour, because that was the speed of a propeller plane, single engine propeller plane. You taught them for 12 weeks, 18 weeks, and made them a pilot and send them. With a fighter jet, you couldn't do that because technology changed everything. So you can't just take a propeller plane pilot and make him do a 2-week advanced course and put him in a jet thing. It doesn't work like that. I mean, the person may not be able to take the G-force, which is there in a supersonic aircraft. So it requires completely ground-up re-engineering. Now, to be able to do that, the organization must have creativity and innovation. Without creativity and innovation, you cannot come up with out-of-the-box ideas, think about horizon changes and all. But to do that, if you need to create an environment of psychological safety where people can dissent, people can think out of the box, people can, only then the three essential ingredients of crisis navigation is possible. The first is that everybody, including the troops, will feel safe in giving out the ground reality. They will not say, anything to handle it, so we're managing it, this, that. I often tell CEOs whom I mentor that on a weekly basis, just call your own office. Just call your own office and say, I want, in this case, to speak to Radhika Gupta, and act a little bit about that incident, in what shape and form you are told, whether you get told at all. Maybe you are told after 2-3 days, ma'am, somebody was calling some screechy person, ma'am, some demented. So try and find out. Now, to be able to do that, you need to have an environment which is safe, where people feel comfortable speaking out their mind. I wanted to tell you about this story here, which is the marshmallow experiment. I think many of you are aware of it, where they find that to build a tower, it's a simple experiment. Google it up later, because I don't want to waste your time now. But essentially, you build a tower using spaghetti and a piece of thermocol or marshmallow. And they found that in this test, CEOs, lawyers, engineers, they're all beaten by a bunch of kindergarten kids, because the kindergarten kids are very creative. They're in a safe environment. They're not doing status management. But if I say this, what will the boss think about me? What will happen? What will happen to my domain? So I think we need to create this environment of psychological safety if we have to think in a different way. And the second one is to remind us that we don't necessarily need to listen to Stockdale syndrome, or the Stockdale paradox story, but listen to it anyway. He was a fighter pilot fighting the Vietnam War. And in 1965, September 9th, I think, he was shot down over Hanoi. He parachuted and he was captured by the local villagers there. And he was in the landing itself, he was injured. His leg was broken. And he was quite brutally tortured he was stationed in the Hau Lo prison, which in the military parlance is also known, obviously black humor. It is known as the Hanoi Hilton. And this was the place where most of the American prisoner of war were incarcerated, a horribly notorious prisoner of war. So Stockdale gets captured and he is tortured for 7.5 years. And it's a long time. It's a long time because you don't know when you will be released. Unlike a prisoner who's kept in jail and told after 10 years you'll be released, at least the guy has a finite horizon. He doesn't know. Stockdale does not know whether he'll live for the next week. And he survives. Not only does he survive the war, he goes on to become a very senior officer in the U.S. Armed Forces. He retires as a rear admiral, I think. And he was also the running mate for Ross Perot in 1992. So almost became vice president. And he was interviewed by another James Collins, another Jim. Jim Collins, who wrote Good to Great. And matter of fact, this story which I'm narrating to you is in that book. It's from that book I am narrating this story. Where Jim Stockdale is interviewed by Jim Collins. And Jim Collins asks him that, how did you manage to do this? I mean, where did you find the mental strength to do it? And Stockdale answers that this came from my deep belief that in the end I will prevail. And these experiences I'm going through, they will be life-changing for me, which when I will look back, I will realize as my most defining moment and would not trade for anything else in my life. But I will also have the hard discipline of realizing that I have to face the brutal challenges of a day-to-day existence. I'll repeat this in a little while, but the more important lesson to be taken is that Jim Collins asks Stockdale that who are the people who didn't make it? And then Stockdale answers, he says that the people who didn't make it, that's pretty easy. The ones who thought that we'll be out of here by Christmas, and Christmas came and they were still here. Then they said, no, by New Year's we'll get out. New Year's came, they were still here. Okay, maybe by Easter. By Easter, they're still here. The next Christmas, next New Year's, they died of a broken heart. So I think there's a lot of lesson to be taken away from what Jim Stockdale teaches us, that we must never confuse faith that in the end we will prevail. I mean, if we don't have that faith, then we might as well lie down and die. So that's not the point. We will prevail. All humankind has always prevailed. We will prevail. And that we cannot afford to lose. But we must have the discipline to confront our daily harsh realities, no matter how brutal they might be. That we may lose loved ones, we may suffer, we may hear bad news all around. But we must have that faith that, listen, in the end, we will prevail. In the end, the basic drills will prevail. Now, the reason why I gave you this story is that I don't think we need to search for Jim Stockdale, and I'm sure you would want to read that book and all of that, or Google him up. I think we are watching these stories all around us. I want to tell you a personal story. On the 24th of last month, I went to take the body of the mother of a very close friend from a mortuary and to the burial ground, to the Kabristan. They were Muslims, and they had nobody in the family to do that. And I went into a hospital where the mortuary guard, who was disheveled, he had probably not slept or definitely not shaved or taken a bath for days. He was standing there. He gave me a form to fill, and he guided me on how to fill the entire form. Then he said, I need a copy of your Aadhaar card. So this is about 8 o'clock at night. So I'm looking around, copy of the Aadhaar card. He takes the Aadhaar card from me. He takes a 5 rupee coin from his pocket and calls the boy and says, is that a photocopy? Get the photocopy. He puts the photocopy, gives me the hands over the body. When the body is loaded into the ambulance, so I don't know how it's done. So I'm doing it, asking friends, and also I've ordered an ambulance. So he says, you don't have to call for an ambulance. Ambulance will be provided by the CMO. You don't have to pay for the ambulance. Maine bulwa liya ambulance. The ambulance is already lined up in front of the mortuary. It's all dark and damp and all of that. So it's not like it's a government hospital. Para-government hospital. So body is loaded into the mortuary van. And then this guard suddenly says, nahi, inka ek bag bhi hai. Ek bag hai, saab tharo, 1 minute bag hai. So of course, I can't identify what that bag is. So he identifies the bag and he says, no, this is the handbag. He puts that bag, puts this. By this time, the ambulance van that I had called, that also arrived. So when he arrived, he was not very angry. He's not angry. Why did you call me when this was already there and all that? So the first van guy had to fill another form. This is in Hindi. I mean, I read Hindi, but it was difficult. 8 o'clock in the night, dark place and all that. The new driver who came, he took the form from his hand. And he wrote every detail in that. And the mobile number was here. He took all the numbers from me, wrote it down and all, gave the parchi. The driver asked me whether I would want to sit in the same van for obvious reasons. I said, no, I'll prefer to travel in the other car. Then he said, okay, which is the Kabristan where we have to go? So this is the Kabristan. I said, I will lead because I know the Kabristan. Went to the Kabristan. There are 5 volunteers there who were in this PP. So this picture is not from there. This is just a symbolic picture which I have put because it was a dark and obviously I didn't take a picture. So 5 of them lowered the body into the grave. They read out the rituals. There were a few family members who were there. All of them were old and frail. Did the entire ritual. And after that, they took off their PPE suits. And they sprayed each other with this disinfectant. And I tried to give both of them a little bit of money. Not because, just out of gratitude. The guard refused to take it in the mortuary until I thrust the money into his wallet, into his pocket and said, use it to help somebody else. Kisi aur ka photo start kara dena type of thing. Like that. these five boys, they were all regular Joes. One of them had a gym, operates a gym. If anyone of you is interested, I'll let you know his name. And another guy is working in a telecom BSNL kind of a company. They are doing it out of just good karma. I don't know. But the point is, these Stockdales are all around us. And I think for every negative story that we read, I'm not getting into the negative positive area, but for every negative story that we read, we need to look at these people. And if we have to create resilience, we have to create at this level. So this resilience is not some amorphous thing which is out there in the air. Resilience is every colony saying, yeah, let's find out who are the old people in a house. Resilience is a young teenage boy of 18 just sliding a parchi under every house and saying, if you need anything, please call me. I'll go out and get it for you. Resilience is people just saying, okay, let's just advance pay, 12 months salary to wherever we can afford, whichever employee can be given that. Let's focus on training our people to adapt to this new world. I mean, I was discussing this with another bunch of people, and forgive my saying so, but those of you who attended my webinar know that I usually speak like a soldier, so I call a point a point. It's been 18 months since the lockdown has happened, and we have migrated so-called to this online world, and I bet less than 20% have trained themselves to even look at the camera while speaking. 18 months later, our leaders still look at the screen while speaking, or they have their web app. So I think we need to really look at how do we develop resilience. This mouthing the word resilience doesn't do anything. Or forwarding WhatsApp to each other about stories of resilience. It is about how do I take this process? How do I create resilience? How do I make these five people far more effective? Can I give them PPE kits? Can I give them a vehicle by which they can move around faster? Can I force multiply their capability by giving them these resources? That, to my mind, is how we create resilience. Resilience is not created by telling stories or even motivational sessions. It is by actually working on those principles and figuring out how to do this. This was an article which appeared a year ago, and it spoke about how by the way, this article is not the main point. In any paradigm shift, businesses will change. The business processes will change. Happened after the Second World War. There were entire new business models which emerged. There were companies which got transformed. Those of you who are interested in bikes and cars and BMW especially ought to know that BMW used to make fighter aircraft engines, and IBM used to do much more naughtier things before. So everyone has to morph and change, and that change will happen. And when that change happens, it will get redistributed. This wealth of the next post-pandemic world, or the prosperity and of course poverty, will also get redistributed. But this redistribution is perhaps the only thing that we can start anticipating and start focusing and working on. That is the only thing that we can do. There is really nothing else that we can do in terms of implementing our leadership sort of skills of a crisis using the principles that I narrated during this session. So with that, I kind of come to the end of my talk. If there are any questions, I'll try to answer them. If I'm not able to answer all your questions, you can follow me on Twitter. Usually the sessions that I do and the follow-up to that, I announce it there. It'll be there. And all yours, Radhika.
Thank you. From offline to online. And no matter what stage you are at in your childhood, I think the last 18 months have been very difficult for parents and children. So what are your thoughts there, Captain? And how do you see that changing post-pandemic?
So I'll tell you, not just for children, for every learning experience, a paradigm shift like this will call us to recreate it. By the way, let me give this to you with practical precedence. So we are not talking in Hawa. You look at the education system of any zone, which is a war zone. You look at Israel, look at Gaza Strip, look at even J&K border areas and all of that. The school system there is very, very fraught with disruption. It can get disrupted at any time. In J&K, it can get disrupted because there's an internet cut or this or that or whatever. It requires the education system to rework the changed parameters from ground up. There is a reason why classes are usually for 45 minutes of length. And there is a reason why TED Talks are usually 18 minutes, because these are two different mediums of absorption of information and they have to be designed differently. There is a reason why big format films like the Avengers and Spider-Man and Superman are made for the big screen. And there is a reason why budget films are made for TV series. It's not the same medium. It's not the same absorption. So I think this belief that whatever we used to do, I touched upon it in my session, whatever we used to do, that 8 classes in a day or 40 minutes each, we will now do in Zoom, we will have everyone taking attendance. It's okay, it's a makeshift behavior. We have to do it now because that's a makeshift. We have to manage and do this transition. But I think this is also a great opportunity to get to the essence of the teaching and say that if instead of 40 minutes class, I had 18 minutes, then what is the essence I would like to teach the next generation? I don't know whether the world of tomorrow will have the luxury, it already doesn't have the luxury of a 5-year training for a doctor. It doesn't have a 7-year training cycle for an architect. So I think very clearly, just like when the, I'm sorry to make this comparison, but I think it's an apt comparison, that in the 70s, a typical airline pilot used to be in the 40s, captain and all used to be in the 50s. And as soon as the aviation boom started, you started seeing pilots at the age of 24, 25 and flight captains at the age of 30, 32 and stuff like that. I mean, in any case, the frontline soldiers, the guys who fly the fighter planes, they're all in their mid-20s and early 30s. So very clearly, we will need to re-engineer our education system. And we will need to take a relook at what are the essential skills that we need to teach our kids and how may we cleave away all unnecessary in the new world flab around that 40 minutes and bring it down to 18 minutes. So of course, I'm not just talking of time. I'm using time as a metaphor. It is not just so you just convert everything from 1 hour to 15 minutes. That's not the point. The point is, how do I take this learning, which was designed through a delivery mechanism in the past, which had the luxury of physical presence, watching teachers, looking, checking people, students are copying, not copying, all of that. That has now changed. How does my testing parameter change? How do my skills change? Maybe handwriting doesn't matter anymore. What matters more would be your ability to speak and impress. Maybe interviews in the future, it's far better to have a face-to-face ability to speak into the camera, rather than a really nice way to write an essay of 8 pages. I don't know. So we have to re-engineer our education system, because our education system can't be following the same map which worked from the 18th century.
I want to just, because you touched on maybe leadership getting younger. I think one of the things, and this came up from a sort of young viewer, is young people are also going through a tricky time. A lot of them are, and I know you've spoken about this issue in the past, a lot of them are graduating from colleges, don't have perhaps the best employment options. There's a natural tendency to be frustrated. What is your advice, as someone who's seen both corporate and government, on how to harness this young energy at this time? And do you think corporate leadership is going to get younger?
I think to answer your last question first, I am not sure corporate leadership is going to get younger. I'll tell you the reason why. Simply, leadership in any industry becomes younger when the industry expands. I gave you the example of the aviation space. I'll give you the example of media. When media houses proliferated, you had a far more number of young editors and all of that, because obviously if a business is expanding, you need more CEOs, you need more marketing heads, you need more channel distributors, you need more. When business is not expanding, the current strata of leaders themselves are getting, sort of no room to move upwards. So I'm not very sure that leadership will, of course, it'll become younger because new business models will come. So when new business models will come, some of the older leaders may not. But if you look at the natural progression by which younger leaders get expansion in any industry, it's only in industries of growth where you get it. Of course, there may be attrition of old leaders because of COVID. But other than that, I don't see an organic reason why that should happen. To answer your first one, and this is true not just for young people, it's true for everybody. It's true for students who are in their last final year, because they are not going to get placements either. It's not like 2022, suddenly everyone will be singing the Kumbaya. So we will have a backlash of the slow growth and its cascading effect on us for, I think, many, many quarters. So the point, I think, is they also need to go back. I keep drilling on the point because it is very important. They need to go back to their fundamental maps and question those maps and say, who says that after finishing 4 years of MBA or whatever, I need to become an employee in a Unilever? Why can't I figure out that in the new world, this will be the services required? And for these services, here are some companies which are providing it. There is still this niche gap, and why can't 8 of us get together and do a startup? Why? I mean, you know, we have always had this culture, and I've mentored a lot of startups. Startups have a culture usually of a bunch of 4 or 5, you know, college guys or girls getting together whose chemistry is very good, who hit upon a great idea, and then they work on that idea. And of course, dozens try it, and maybe 2-3 succeed in it, and 1 or 2 becomes a real unicorn and, you know, becomes the iconic sort of beacon around which everyone else also chases. It's a bit like, I don't know how many thousand people come to Bombay every week, not these days, but earlier, ki main Shah Rukh Khan banunga. Usme se Shah Rukh Khan kaun banta hai? But the rest will also give it a try, and this will happen. But why not do it a different way? Why not decide that if we are to architect a service for which there is a gap in the market, then 18 of us have the skill sets. You are good in finance. You are good in, maybe we don't have a chemistry, physics, biology. That doesn't matter. But we have the skill set within the class of 2022. And rather than waiting for something to happen, why don't we start working in our last few semesters to actually construct a business plan and say, we will construct a business plan and we'll test that business plan with the 18 of us, and we will found a company, because naukri to milne wala nahi hai. 18 logon ko to naukri milega nahi. So I think these are the ways in which we have to restart thinking. And it happens in every wartime. It happens in wartime. Our industries prop up, black market props up. There are completely hooch making happens. There's so many innovations. I'm not suggesting any one of these, by the way, but I'm just saying that innovation actually happens under constraint. And I think students who are in their final year, or young people who are in their careers, and of course, none of this takes away the pain of having to pay an EMI. But it does remind people that if you are alive and you are healthy, then you are part of a very, very lucky minority. And therefore, if it means shifting into a smaller flat, if it means sharing, if it means families separating with the wife and kids, saying, okay, for 1 year, we'll live in a low cost, you know, city like, I don't know, outskirts of Pune, whereas the husband takes a smaller apartment in Bombay. These kind of models will have to be done to sail through a war. In wartime, there are ration cuts, there are, you know, blackouts, and this is war. So we need to get that mindset. Once we get that mindset, frustration should go away, because now you are working on concrete things. Hmm. You can't frustrate your way out of a crisis. That's for sure. You can only work your way out of a crisis. So once you accept ki boss, ye 12-13 quarter wala mamla hai. Do 3 saal ka mamla hai. Long run. I mean, of course, COVID will ebb and all of that, but the economy will change. Tourism is not going to take off. Real estate is going to be slow and take off. There'll be many other industries which will get affected, and that will have a cascading effect. Elections are coming up. Summer is approaching. Monsoons are coming. So all of these will create their own cyclonic disturbances. So I think in that environment, for us to be able to say, how will the world change? What are the skills I need to develop? How may I inorganically start figuring out how to get that end goal is the best way for young people as well.
I want to ask you a question, actually 2 questions about mental health. And I know this is an issue that you have spoken about extensively. One is from the perspective of the individual, and there are a couple of people writing in that you spoke about creativity and agility and relearning. And at this time, there is a tendency to get negative and to have this inertia of not wanting to do anything. So how do you overcome that? And the second is that how do all of us, and it's not just companies, but even in our homes, create an environment where people feel safe to talk to each other and raise issues when they come up?
So, of course, the good news about crisis is usually it lowers the hesitancy bar. I don't want to maybe sound macabre, but in another session that I did, ironically for a very similar audience, my conversation was, maybe it's time for fathers to have a chat with their teenage kid and explain to them that, God forbid, if something goes wrong, these are the papers, this is where the money is kept, these are the people you can trust, these are people who owe us money, having those conversations with them, making sure that every person has got a joint account just in case something happens. Their own money should not lie in the bank locked up because the next of kin is trying to prove they are next of kin for months together. Now, these conversations are necessary conversations to have. And these conversations give a sense of hope also. They give a sense that, okay, if something does happen to me, I've made my affairs in order. And it also allows for difficult conversations to take place. I'm pretty certain, and I'm making this up like a Hindi movie, but I'm pretty certain that a lot of young couples must have confronted their parents and said, you know what, we are in love and we want to get married. We were thinking of telling you next year and all of that, but you know what, this is life is too short. This life is too short is a phrase which is the positive aspect of a bad situation. Because actually, if you've ever been to Israel, you should see the nightlife of Israel. Because there is really that sense of life is short, which is reinforced constantly. And so people, so I'm not again encouraging that we should have a nightlife. I'm saying that we must have that sense of finiteness, which is true. It is always true. It was always true. But a crisis reminds us that there is a sense of finiteness in everything. And maybe we should start looking at other parts of the Maslow's hierarchy of needs than the material part. Because we discovered that material part, okay, fine, yeah, it's important. It's important to have the investments and all. But it is not something that you need to be obsessed by. And because there are many other, life is short. That sort of mantra comes in. I think that's a good way to focus on. Mental health will be a challenge. And if you remember, that's why I began the story with that sinking ship, that when the tide goes down, then everybody goes down with the tide. And we may not realize it, but I speak extensively about mental health because I am convinced personally, with my own experiences in the army and my own personal experiences, that we are facing a challenge which is arguably the strangest challenge in the world, because the term is called post-traumatic stress disorder, which presumes that the trauma is post. Now, ironically, in an 18-month trauma or in a world war of 4 years or 5 years, it is not post-traumatic. It's even during the trauma, you are under severe stress or depression or whatever. Now, the depressed mind cannot come up with a good solution. That's the problem. It's like contaminated water. If water is contaminated, you cannot cook a good meal with it. It's not possible to cook a good meal with contaminated water or smelly water. You cannot. You can put the best ingredients in it. It will not be a good, it will have the smell of that stench. Now, the thing is that unless, therefore, we get a people in a good state of mind. So I'm telling this from a practical experience. This is not very psychological mumbo jumbo and, you know, pop psychology. If there is a unit in a battalion which has gone through a very bad skirmish, or it's got a lot of casualties, or a bad set of luck, coincidence, one accident, then a firing mishap, a grenade explodes, so three deaths in a gap of 10 days, and people start getting afraid. And soldiers are very superstitious, and rightfully so. So they'll say that, you know, there is something we have done wrong, or this thing or that thing. At that point of time, to break that logjam, to read, you know, so I'm telling this is a practical thing which happened exactly maybe 10 days ago. I was scheduled to do a workshop for a major oil and gas company. And on one day before that, they decided to cancel it. And they decided to cancel it because they said that we have had a few deaths of our employees. Mm-hmm. So we wanted to cancel it. So I spoke to the chairman and I said that in the army, especially in the paratroopers, if there is an accident in the para jumping, the entire battalion is sent back again. So if one parachute doesn't open, God forbid, there's a fatality or an accident, the whole battalion is sent back again to do the jump again, because you cannot allow that crisis to jam your brain. So the first thing I think we need to do is to recognize that each and every one of us will be affected by a mental health challenge. So when you look up the statistics, it tells you that 1 in 5 will have mental health. This is a misleading sentence. It's a bit like saying 1 in 5 will have viral fever or conjunctivitis. It could be any 1 in 5 at any given point in time. So it's true that in a group of 10 people in the earlier world, not today, now after the COVID, I'm sure the percentage will be much worse. But in the earlier world, if you said 20% of the people are in some shape or form suffering from mental health, then this 20% is a round robin. Everyone is suffering it at some point of time. And experts will tell you mental health or stress. Actually, stress and mental health and depression are nothing but sadness. And sadness will affect every individual, every maybe 4 or 5 or 6 years, a major sadness, a sad event will happen in their life. It will happen. So for a family who loses their breadwinner in a road accident, it doesn't matter whether it's a road accident or a COVID accident. The repercussions are exactly the same for them. So to that extent, we will have to realize and accept this is a challenge. We'll have to accept the challenge. But once we have accepted this challenge, we also have to recognize that we have to work our way out of this challenge. And that is why we need to focus on improving our morale. Now, as individuals, I can give you some good tips which have worked for me. They work very well for me. Switch off news. Switch off news, switch off all news feed, switch off Twitter, switch off every community. I'll tell you the reason why. And I want to give you an example of the way the brain works. It's a very important example. If the kids listening out there, it's very, very valuable for them and for parents also. Our brain has a concept called attention residue, which means that if I'm paying attention to something and I switch my attention to something else, there is a residue of that attention of the previous task. This has been proven clinically. You can actually try this at home with a very simple experiment. Now that I tell you the answer, you may not be good subjects, but try it with people who don't know this. I've done it zillions of times in my sessions. You take a group of people, a group of students, 50s to or whatever, even managers, leaders, and you give them two problems. One problem is a problem where all the answers, the variables are given to them, and they have to solve it. The second problem is that some of the variables are not given to them. This is the structure of that test. The first test is very simple. It is unscrambling jumbled up words. Hmm. So all the answers are there because the alphabets are there. All the alphabets are there. The second one is there is a jar which is full of marbles. And the jar is kept at a table and you are given one marble as a size reference and told, okay, you have to estimate how many marbles are in that jar. So after the first test, the entire group comes and it does the estimation of the second test. And here is the miraculous second test finding that 50% of the people overestimate the number of marbles by a wide margin. And 50% of the people underestimate the margin, the number of balls by a wide margin. The reason for that is that the group were given two different sets of words to unjumble. One group was given words like gigantic, supernova, light year, explosion, juggernaut, mammoth, elephant. The other group was given insect, fly, bacterial, atomic, needle, pinpoint. They were compelled to think in tiny, small things, and another group, and that attention residue carried forward. So if you're constantly watching news, and bad news, then from this channel to that channel, the buddy politicians are not working. Look at the number of ventilators lying, vacant, and this is not happening. People are dying and all of that. Your brain subliminally is going to get wired to that. And you're going to get sinking more and more and more and more into it. I think the best thing for us right now is to focus consciously on improving resilience. And the best way to improve resilience is actually by the examples I gave you. Make sure you know every neighbor of yours. Mm-hmm. Make sure you know that your neighbor knows that in case they need any sort of help, your car is available, you're available, you got PPE suits, it is there, food ka zarurat hai, you need anything. I am going that direction anyway. Is there something that you need me to do? Nominal role of people who are living in the society, making sure that drivers are assured that we will vaccinate you and your family. Don't worry about it. We'll get that done. Giving cash allowances to sweepers, cleaners, telling the cops who are outside on the street, please come use the bathroom. If you want to use the bathroom, you want to use the shower, you want to charge your phone, you are more than welcome to do that. These are the mechanisms by which resilience is created. And if we start doing these kind of activities, I mean, those five people I spoke about who are burying bodies, they're not fools. They know the risk they are taking. They've got families, they've got kids, and they're not doing it out of some nobility. But they are those essential wheels of the society which are building resilience. Otherwise, what happens to the bodies? Yeah, the bodies will be lying on the ground. So I think this resilience needs to be created, and the only way out of that mental health funk is doing that resilience. It's as simple as that. It's actually doing those tasks. So I know we all have, I have some days which are very bad days, and you don't feel like, oh, fuck, today I don't feel like doing anything, and you know, everything pretty gloomy, and this is also bad, and weather is also bad, and it works on you. But you've got to say, you have to take that deep breath and go back to that Stockdale paradox. Remind yourself of the story of these five boys and 50 million such boys who cannot say no. Their livelihood depends on it. They have to use, look at that Swiggy delivery guy. He is delivering food to I don't know how many COVID infected patients every day, and he has no way to say no because he needs that 8,000 rupees at home. Compared to them, we need to seriously ask ourselves, do we even have the luxury to say that I have a mental health issue? I mean, of course, it's still, it's clinical. It's not something in our hands. It's not something that people are moping about because they want to mope about. It is clinical. It's a serotonin dip. It happens. It's biological. But I think we need to constantly reaffirm connections with others, look at people who are far worse off than us, share with them whatever we can. And I think that's the way we pull ourselves out of it. It's like crossing a very a river in high spate. Let's say there is a river which is in high spate. You know, there's only one way to cross it. Only one way to cross it. Everybody ties each other by their wrists. Ties each other. And then one by one, the person go. Of course, the first few guys will be blown off by the river. But if people keep on letting go, eventually one guy will catch the other side, and then they will catch each other, and then they'll pull the tail from there. That's the only way to get out of a global crisis. We have to hold each other's wrists. And we have to hold everybody's wrist in the... You can't say only by eight of us, we family will hold each other's wrist. All eight of you will sink together. So it has to be the entire society who's... wrist is held together. And I think it's a very important lesson which we'll take away post-COVID. Today, all people who have drivers are getting their driver's medical health checkup done, because if he's got COVID, they will also get COVID. That was true. That was true even for TB. It was even true for cardiac arrest. It was true for myopia. It was true for cancer. It was true for everything. But at that point of time, if he had cancer, you could replace him. And cancer is not contagious. Heart attack may not happen while he's driving, so it's okay. But COVID can, TB can. I think some of those practices which we have learned now, that you know, we depend on everybody. These practices we need to carry forward after COVID as well. And hopefully we will come out as a stronger world.
And by the way, the comment you made about news is very true about investing also. The best thing I think we say is turn off the news. But I'm going to ask you one last question at the risk of exceeding 5 minutes of time, because it's something that you've talked about a lot. It's close to me also. And it's about communication and storytelling. This comes from an Edelweiss employee, actually, a member of our team, that, you know, storytelling has been used, war examples have been used, sports examples have been used. What will the relevance of storytelling be, you know, in a time like this? How can it be used effectively? And also to all of us, one of the points that you made, Captain, was about online communication, and all of us are doing online communication. So how can we incorporate that better in online communication?
No, for that we'll do a separate workshop. That requires a separate... I'm not being humorous about it. I'm actually being genuine. It's a bit like you are really asking a question that we were flying propeller planes earlier. How do I fly jet planes now? So I can give that motherhood element, some of which I already did. At the very least, I think all of us should invest in a good camera and good lighting. That should be there. That's a very minimum. So uske aage we will talk about how we use the frame of reference and all of those things. But that's not the point. I think the question that you asked...
Storytelling.
Yeah. So I actually want to use an example from my own session, right? I began this session, the first few slides, you saw that shot by Danish Siddiqui, which shows the crematorium. And I ended my session with another shot of a graveyard. The stories were different. In the first story, it was a story of mayhem. It was a story of chaos. It was a story of frustration and helplessness. In the second slide, exactly the same picture. But the story was of five heroes who are putting their life on the line so that they can give a burial to somebody, a decent burial to somebody, an Assange and family, that even if you were not there, it was done as well. It's the same scene. We are both looking at the same scene. But how you create a frame around that scene is how the way the brain absorbs it. Now, unfortunately, I'm giving you the science of bad news. Unfortunately, a human being is far more titillated. The word is titillated with bad news.
Yeah.
Right? So if I tell you, you are a very bad person, Radhika, you will see, you know, immediately start, your adrenaline will start pumping. But if I say, I really think you're a good person, your first response, really? Because you're surprised. Good news is surprising. Really? But bad news is taken straight away. So if a piece of rope falls on you in a dark bungalow, you will immediately jump off thinking it's a snake. And that's why you're alive, because your ancestors thought that way. If they thought it was a rope, they'd be dead. You wouldn't have ancestors. You wouldn't be alive. So genetically, we have been programmed to be titillated by accidents. That's why, you know, we always see in the road where there's an accident, people are looking at it like that. Macabre. They keep looking at it. Why? Macabre attracts us. Death attracts us, because there is a long philosophy. We'll get into it in another session sometime. So negative news, when it comes in, not only is it far more likely to have an impact, but its impact is also much harder. Much, much harder. So I think we must consciously stay away. And the point I wanted to make, yeah, that's the point I forgot, that when our brain is absorbing information, I'll give you a very simple example of reading a book. So, you know, I like to read a lot, and a lot of my friends ask me this very often, that do you like to read on regular book or Kindle? And I tell them I prefer a regular book. And here is the reason why. Our brain can only operate in one mode. We have two modes of operation. One is what is called an introspection and deep thinking. And another is a problem solving. You're solving a problem. You're looking to solve a problem. So when you read a mystery novel, you're problem solving. You're trying to figure out what's happening. You're trying to second guess the author. Whereas when you are reading Rumi or poetry, you're introspecting. You're looking at one line. You're looking at the words. You're looking at the application to your life and stuff like that. These are two different modes in which the brain works. Now, if you decide that I am going to be introspective in my process, and you decide I'm going to read a book and get into introspection in this, and you are tempted by an advertisement which comes in between, or a pop-up which comes up between, or a highlighted word which comes up, or even a word whose meaning you don't know in Kindle. You don't know the meaning of that word. In a normal book, unless you are the kind who will go and pick up the dictionary and all, which I never do, you will try and make out the meaning of that word by and large. You will try and make out the meaning by the surrounding context, and you will figure out, and later on at some point you will come across that word and say, I was more or less right, or I was wrong. But in Kindle, you have the option of clicking on that word and immediately going into a dictionary and Wikipedia and examples and a phonetic example of it and all of that. So what happens is, from the introspective way in which your brain was going, you snap and you go into a problem solving. And the introspective ways, attention residue of the problem solving comes back when you switch back to introspection. And therefore, your reading of a same content online becomes maybe 10% of its efficacy of what used to be when you are doing deep work, deep focused work. So one of the things I would definitely recommend is for everybody now to spend 2 to 3 hours every day on doing one activity which is going to improve them dramatically. It can be an activity of writing, to say, I'm going to become a writer. I'll write my experiences in LinkedIn or whatever. I'm going to learn video editing. It's going to be a skill which will be important in the future. I am going to learn, I normally don't recommend something esoteric or whatever, but I'm going to learn. I am, as you're aware, Radhika, doing a serious, very, very serious course on magic. And yeah, not magic because I want to become a magician, but because the psychology of magic, the science of magic, the science of psychology and all of that. So put a discipline around your life. Put a stake that is important, a deadline that is important for you to cover, more than just appearing every day for a 10 o'clock briefing call or something like that. But something that you look forward to. You have to find something to look forward to and remove bad news surgically. I'll give you an example. You know, I have this in another presentation of mine, a slide of a man who's building a earth vase. You know, that potter's wheel, right? And it's a beautiful, it's just very exquisite, because you have to apply, if you have ever tried doing it, it's very difficult. Looks very easy, but very, very difficult, because you have to apply the right pressure and bring it up like that. Now imagine if in that condition, somebody were to tap him on the shoulder, hey, tera SMS aaya, hey, Twitter, new messages come, new Facebook, like, guy will go mad. He won't be able to. Now that's the world we are living in. Whenever we are trying to do something, our brain is not being allowed to go into the introspection mode before a new thing comes, and a new thing comes, and suddenly a new breaking news, flashing news, this thing, that thing. So we are constantly on the edge. You ever seen a monkey from whom we originate, a primate from whom we originate? A primate is always darting about, always looking around, like it's constantly looking at the environment for threat. You'll never see a monkey staring at the sunset and, you know, thinking about poem or, you know, because they don't have that faculty. Now, what is happening is this constant titillation all around us, which is primarily fueled by news, and secondly, fueled by the method in which we have started consuming all content, which is primarily online. You know, you're reading news also online, website online, YouTube online, all of that stuff. So a lot of it is not in our control. And you can try this out. Just try this out for one day and you will realize how true I am. Try out actually writing down why you picked up the phone and what you ended up doing. And you will realize that you don't have control of that instrument the moment you pick it up, because you may have gone in to punch a WhatsApp message. You'll read something and you'll immediately go there. You'll click it. Then you'll wander around either or there. It's like a rat in a maze. You will wander around. You are smiling, but that's true. People are trusting you with billions of dollars, by the way, right? And you are behaving like a rat who, you know, sort of go off into a maze and, you know, to look like, look at this. And you're going away. So I think we need to consciously recognize that that instrument is doing it to us. And the way to make that happen is to consciously set aside a couple of hours to begin with, and maybe then 4 hours or 5 hours to do deep work. There's a whole concept we'll talk about some other day of how do you create that, you know, whole framework of deep work. Last thing, which I think I would definitely advise organizations, is that they must formally induct a capability of counseling and basically counseling, especially bereavement counseling. Bereavement counseling is a very, very important part, because I'll tell you something very interesting. I've studied the science behind this. I mean, I've gone deep into it. The mental condition of depression is defined by a body of doctors in the US, and they create this book which says that if you display these symptoms, then you have mental health.
Yeah.
They always had a challenge. And the challenge was that the symptoms of mental health, specifically depression, is exactly the same symptom of sadness. So if you lose a loved one, and then you don't feel like eating, you don't feel like, you feel like, I don't want to get out of bed, I want the world to end. It is exactly the same symptom of mental health. So this body came up with a way to break the logjam, and they gave a timeline. They said that if you lose a loved one and if you are in that state for 1 year, then it is okay, you're sad. But after 1 year, it becomes depression. And then you will be administered drugs and given counseling and all of that. But that 1 year kept reducing until it's reduced now to 1 month. So if you have a bereavement, and by the way, this has very clear, it has to be next of kin. So if a person has a dog and that lady has been in love with the dog and the dog dies and she exhibits the same behavior, it is not classified under sadness. It will be depression and you will be prescribed drugs for it. So I think we really need to mainstream this issue. And for that, a good beginning would be for organization. And I'll tell you, this is existential for organization, because if you want to create an organization that will be resilient and flexible and agile, you need leadership that is vulnerable. That is okay to say, hota yaar, humko bhi, even I feel like this some days, yaar. But I wake up in the morning, I don't feel like. You can't have a leader who says, nobody should do like this. And if you do like this, you are weak people. You are weak and you are strong and you are alpha. You do that, you will end up with, you know, Sun Tzu had a very famous saying in his Art of War. He spoke about one of his generals and he spoke about him very highly. He said, General Chang Le, whatever his name was, he's a great warrior. He knows no pain. He knows no fear and he knows no hunger. And he says, that's why I never gave him troops to command, because my troops know fear, my troops know pain, and my troops know hunger. So if you want to create an organization where you have vulnerable leaders who are asking more, that I don't know, samjhao ya kaise karne ka, chalo, we'll all put our minds together and come out with a solution, let's figure it out, chalo, let's figure out a way to get out of this, that vocabulary is the vocabulary that is needed to be conveyed much more than I know everything we have done. हमने देखा हुआ पहले भी हुआ था इधर है ना. My brother-in-law got a shot. You know, he knows exactly how it is done. You don't need those kind of leaders now. Those kind of leaders will end up in trouble. So to create that kind of a situation, you need a formal recognition of the fact that we as an organization acknowledge that just like physical health of our, you know, fascinating part of the story, I consult with certain organizations, really remarkable, who spend 2.5 lakh on a chair, but will not spend 5,000 rupee on a counseling session. Right? So it's basically, we are in the industrial age where we are saying, so long as he sits in front of a machine and pumps up so many screenshots or Excel sheets, he has done his 8 hours work. We are not in that space where we say, if I get my creative team to be really thinking out of the box, really thinking out of the box. By the way, just to finish that anecdotal story, the BMW motorcycle, which is one of the most popular motorcycles on the road today, as it's known, the GS, its engine's origin was the fighter aircraft's engine. So when the Bavaria Motor Works were closing down, they took their most creative guy and they sent him off into, you know, the chateau and said, you spend some time there in figuring out how to get out of this mess. And he comes out and he saves the existence of the company. So I think if we need our employees to be in that state of mind where they're looking at it creatively, where then we have to acknowledge that, yes, just like your physical health, we are also concerned about your mental health, and we put proper frameworks for it. Many companies, I don't want to name them, think they're putting up a framework. So I knew one company which put up a helpline. And of course, they're doing it with the best of intentions, right? Best of intentions. They put up a helpline and they got an NGO with, I'm also mentoring that NGO who work with counseling bereaved, they give bereavement counseling. So they got them on a retainer. And they also agreed on the contract that they will pay them per patient. Now, somewhere, of course, the finance and the HR processes intermingle. And the finance said, send me the list of the people whom you have counseled. Then I will know how many, you know, slots to release to you, how much money to pay. So obviously the NGO said, we can't tell you who. No, then we can't pay you because we have no audit. So I think we need to get far, far beyond that. Because if you put up a helpline in which the employee knows that if I go seek counseling 4 times in a month, my reporting manager will come to know of it. So why are you putting it? You might as well hang ropes with a noose on it and put a stool and say, please climb in for on behalf of management, we are doing for you. We have put up a rope and a stool. Please come in. So I think we need to really get to the essence. And this is also the time where I genuinely believe that we need empathetic leaders. We need empathetic HR people. We need popular leaders. We need popular leaders who have the ability to, you know, connect with people who are not distanced from people. We need those kind of people. So I think, yeah, that's my sort of short answer, not short, but answer to it.
I've learned so much in this conversation, and as one of our viewers just posted on YouTube, with someone like you, you can just keep listening for hours. But I want to thank you for all the insights today evening. And I also want to thank so many people who've been here for now about 100 minutes on a holiday, listening to us and putting in their comments and sharing. Sort of.
How many people came, Radhika? But I don't know. I can see.
I actually don't have the numbers because it's across platforms, but there are also not people here. And, you know, they just haven't dropped out. You know, usually after a 1 hour session, you suddenly see people dropping out and they're just there. So it's incredible. And some of the questions are very meaningful and they're very from the heart. So I'm thankful to
I'm happy. I'm happy to do this, Radhika, that I know that some people may not be have been got a chance to ask their questions. And frankly, some questions they may not also want to ask in a public forum. So you can tweet me. My Twitter handle is @CaptRaman, CaptRaman. And if you just tweet me, I'll answer those questions. And hopefully we'll meet again, Radhika, with your
Absolutely. And I would end for the audience on the note, you know, the lines that you quoted, that whatever we go through, these experiences will be life changing. But in the end, hopefully all of us will prevail, or we will prevail. We always prevail.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.